Fine. So I'll create one topology over here, and might be that I'm already having that one. So this is going to be your diagram now. So as you can see in this diagram that we are having one service provider, which is BT, British Telecom. This is your service provider, right? This BT is working here as a service provider. Now, the second thing is, like, with this service provider, you have two customers connected. One is Microsoft and another one is Yahoo. And both of them are, both customers are having two different sites. Like Microsoft is having New York and Gurgaon sites. So Microsoft will be these two sites will be interconnected with the help of BT, because at both ends, Microsoft have taken connection, or you can say MPLS link from BT. In same manner, Yahoo is also having two different offices over here, London and Paris. So because it is having London and Paris, so again these two sites are connected with each other with using BT. The very first thing that I will implement here MPLS with BGP without using VRF. Are you getting my point or not? Without using VRF, and then I will show you that if you do not use VRF in MPLS, then again there will be a big problem. You understand? So let me prove that first of all. So let me have the console of R1, then R2, then R3. Interface loop back one, first of all, I have to do the configuration of its internal network. I mean BT's internal network. Internally it is using area, and then on the top of the OSPF we can configure indirect BGP neighborship, is not it? So BGP AS 100 is running for British Telecom, right? BT. So you do one thing, move on R1. Say router OSPF1, router ID is going to be 111 S1/0, IP OSPF1 area is going to be 0. Any problem? So on both interfaces, on to the loopback of R1 as well as on its one interface, we have enabled OSP. You check it out. Then move on R2, and on R2 router ID will be 2222, and then enable OSPF on all interfaces of R2, and area will be 0. You see, then on R3, router OSPF1 router ID will be 333, interface S1/0, as I can show you these interfaces as well. S1/0 IPO SPF1 area is going to be 0, and once again it is 0. Any problem? Sure. Good. After implementing OSPF, now we have to implement MPLS in this network. Right now, if you move on R1, show MPLS forwarding. Does it have anything over here? To enable OS, this MPLS, go to interface, and then what do you need to configure? MPLS IP. But there is one another option also available by which you can enable MPLS onto your interfaces of your devices, right? Like router OSPF 1. You can say MPLS LDP autoconfig. Now, the meaning of this command is what? Like MPLS will get enabled on all those interfaces on which OSPF process 1 is enabled. Except loopback interfaces, because MPLS will never get enabled onto loopback interfaces. So now even we can see that MPLS is enabled onto its WAN interface or not. Show MPLS interfaces. You see, on S1/0 LDP is running. In same manner, I'll move on R2, I'll move under OSPF, and then I'll say MPLS LDP auto config. And then you can move on R3 as well. You can say MPLS LDP auto config. So now show MPLS interface. Check it out. See LDP peering have came up now. Now you must be able to see R3's loopback in your router's routing table, in the routing table of R1, as well as on R3 you must be able to see the loopback of R1. Now because MPLS is also running, so LFIP will be there, right? So MPLS forwarding table. So to reach 3333, its outgoing label is what?
17.
And if R2 receives anything with the label number 17, it will perform popping, because PHP is by default enabled. But it will send it out from S1/1. Finally, your packet will reach R3. Fine. MPLS is configured. OSPF is configured. BT has been configured except BGP. We have configured this service provider except BGP. I'll also configure this BGP as well, right? But before going for that, let me enable RIP in between Microsoft CE and this PE1. This is provider edge, right? This is P router, and this is once again provider edge router. So let me have the console of Microsoft CE1 first of all now, and then of Microsoft CE2. Let's start it from Microsoft CE1 now. Do one thing, go to FA0/0, allocate IP address as 1.1 over here. Create loopback interfaces. Loopback 2. 3. 4. 5. Show IP interface brief. Check it out. On Microsoft CE2, IP address is going to be 2.1, as you can see in diagram. Loopback 10.1.6.1 2 3 4 Now we have to enable RIP in between PE1 provider edge 1 and this Microsoft CE1. Move on PE1 now. See, you can even you can allocate its host name as PE1 as well. So this is what PE1. Then move on FA0 by 0 and allocate its IP address as 1.2. We have to configure version and then say 1.0. Router RIP version 2, no auto, summary network. Show IP RIP database. RIP has enabled over here. Move on PE1. Show IP route RIP. It has learned all those prefixes, right? And they are installed in its global routing table. Have you understood it or not? Fine. Then in between PE1 and PE2, because PE2 is R3, right? So allocate, rename it as well, PE2. So on PE1, say router, tell me, BGP 100. You understand? Router BGP 100. It will pick its router ID automatically. It will pick it. There will not be any problem, right? And then after, say no BGP default IP v4 unicast. No BGP default IP v4 unicast. And then after it, say address, sorry, first of all, define your neighbor 333, remote AS is what, and then 3333, update sources loopback, and then say address family IP, v4, neighbor, activate, finally move on, PE2, say router BGP, 100, you understand? And then no BGP default IP v4 unicast, say neighbor, neighborship must come up. Now by default prefixes can move from RIP into BGP, will they go from RIP into BGP automatically? So for that purpose, you have to perform redistribution. Like on PE1, you are receiving prefixes coming from Microsoft CE1 with the help of RIP. As you can see, show IP route, all of them are there with the help of RIP. Like you can see, show IP route RIP. Do one thing, redistribute them into BGP. Router, BGP 100 address family IPv4. As you can say unicast as well, and then say redistribute RIP. And then check this BGP table. All of them now must be, and one more thing. Now there will be two conditions, either this WAN 1.0 will be redistributed into BGP or not. So what do you want? Do you want to redistribute it into BGP? No, let's do one thing, let's exclude this prefix from redistribution, right? I'll redistribute only these 5 prefixes of customer. For doing that, I'll say access list 1, deny, then 1 permit, route map, match IP address 1. Router, sorry, address family IP, and then you configure this command over here, say what the name, check its BGP table. Now gone, fine. Now move on R3. You must be able to get all of them onto R3. What's that? They are there, but they are not best. Reason being, next hop was not modified, and now it is not reachable from here. And in BGP to become best path, very first condition is what? That your next hop address must be reachable. Sardeep, are you okay with it? To make it possible, what can you do here? Either modify its next hop address with the help of route map, or use next hop self command. Because you can also use next hop self command, because these all prefixes are redistributed prefixes, right? So inside BGP, address family IPv4 unicast neighbor 3.3.3 and then say next hop. Remember, next hop self will be configured under address family mode if you are using address family for your neighbor, right? Then after move on R3, and then you will check its BGP table. See, now it have become best, because now next hop is configured as 1.1.1. But remember that if you are receiving prefixes coming from IPGP neighbor, one of the IPGP neighbor, and you are advertising that towards another IPGP neighbor, then definitely this command will never work. It will never work, and we proved it in BGP. So finally, we have received these prefixes onto B2 now, and see, still there is a black hole. Like on R2, you can see that there is no prefix like 10, 10, 10, 10. Is there? Onto R2, of course no, because we are not running BGP onto R2. Then after, we have to configure EIGRP in between Gurgaon site and PE2. So do one thing, move on PE2 now, and onto its FA0/0 IP address is going to be 2.2, and then say router EIGRP is what is also 100, not of somebody network 192.168.2.0, and then I will move on Microsoft CE2. I'll configure EICRP 100 itself, and then I'll say not of summary, and then network 0000, and you will see that now your neighborship will come. Fine. On PE2, show IP route. All these 10 prefixes are there. Some of them are coming with the help of BGP, some of them are coming with the help of EICRP. Now, first of all, I'll take New York site prefixes onto Gurgaon site. So now onto PE2, it will be required for me to redistribute BGP back into EIGRP. So do one thing, onto PE2 itself, move inside EIGRP 100, say redistribute BGP 100, and then it is mandatory to specify your matrix 1500, 1540, 255, 1 and 1500. So now I must be able to see all those prefixes into topology table of EIGRP which were coming with the help of BGP onto this device, right? So to check that, show IP EIGRP topology. You can see now they are not there. Have we done some mistake over here? Remember that by default BGP do not redistribute internal prefixes. I mean all those prefixes which are learned from IPGP neighbor into any IGP. For doing that, router BGP 100 address family IP v4 unicast BGP redistribute internal. Once you will configure this command, now you see show IP EIGRP topology. See, all of them are there. 1, 2, 3 redistributed. Is not it? And now you can find all these prefixes onto Microsoft CE2. Check it out. same manner, now you have to take your prefixes from Gurgaon side to Microsoft, I mean New York side. So of course on P2 you are receiving them with the help of EICRP itself. Now you are required to redistribute the EICRP back into BGP on to P2. Say router BGP 100 at assembly IPv4 unicast, say redistribute EICRP 100. So IPv4, you must get all of them over here. And again it will see, it will redistribute this 2.0 as well. So this time again, if I do not configure next hop self, then also it will be best onto R1. Because now next hop address have been advertised into BGP itself. Hello, this. So that is why it is best, because next hop is reachable. But if I do something like additional redistribution onto PE2, like if I do not want to advertise this 2.0, if I do not want to redistribute this 2.0 into the BGP, then the same problem will occur over there that we saw onto PE1. Like access list 1 deny 181.68.2.0, and then it's some wildcard mask and 1 permit any, and then after what can we do? Route map, it's test and permit 1 match IP address is 1, and then router BGP is what, and then at assembly IPv4 unicast, and then redistribute this route map name is IP BGP. You must not get that 2.0 now into its BGP table, and now on PE1 they will not be best, because now their next hop address is not reachable. That's why I just filter out that. Otherwise of course we will have not configured, you understand, this next hop self command onto any provider edge router. But this time it was mandatory, it was compulsory for us to configure this command, because without configuring this command, next hop is not reachable. That's why I filter it out. So on to P2 router BGP 100 at assembly IPv4, and then I can say unicast neighbor 1.1.1, and then next hop self. Just after configuring this command under address family, now move on our P1, and you will see that then after you have to redistribute this BGP back into RIP. So say router RIP redistribute BGP metric is 2. It's mandatory to specify your metric while you are redistributing into RIP. But still show IP RIP database, you will not get that, I mean all those prefixes into the database of RIP. You know by default BGP will not redistribute internal prefixes, right? So router BGP 100 address family IPv4 unicast, say BGP redistribute internal, just after configuring this command, say show IP RIP database. Check it out. See all of them are available now. 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, everything. Move back again on Microsoft CE1 via RIP, you must be able to see all of them now. But still on to R2, I mean core router of service provider, you will not get any one of the route. Is there? Tell me. Fine. Then after it, move on Microsoft CE1 and then try to ping with 10.1.6.1 when source is your on loopback, and repeat. Have we configured any CRE tunnel?
No.
So this is happening due to MPLS. And how will you ensure that, okay, you are communicating with Microsoft CE2 itself? Do one thing, move on Microsoft CE2 and enable Telnet. Yes. Take Telnet off when source is Raji, it confirms that we are communicating with Microsoft CE2 router itself. Say exit, we'll come out from here. Now, big question is that how traffic is going from here to there and how traffic is coming back from here, from there to here. Fine. To understand that, it's very easy. See, this Microsoft CE2, CE1 actually is preparing packet, and in that packet, source IP address is 10.1.1. Destination packet, destination IP address was 6.1. This was your packet. First of all, Microsoft CE1 will perform routing lookup in its local routing table. Fine. Now the CE1 is receiving this prefix coming from, tell me, 1.2, as you can see. So it will hand over this packet to 1.2. Fine. R1 will receive this packet onto F0/0 now, and because it received here unlabeled packet, was there any label onto it? No, it received unlabeled packet, and I have already taught you the rule that if any router receives any unlabeled packet, then it will perform lookup in its FIB, and here it will perform lookup in its global FIB. Global FIB, because this interface is part of global routing table itself, right? So it will simply say this R1 show IP ceph 10.1.6.0 and then detail. Are you getting my point or not? Hey, this R1 has received one unlabeled packet onto FA0/0, so it has to perform lookup in its FIB. See, what's that? That to reach it, next hop is going to be 333, and it is reachable via S1/0, and also fast tag rewrite. It means that MPLS is enabled onto this interface, and it is going to impose label number 70 onto this packet now. So in between layer 2 and layer 3 header, it will put label number 70. It will add this tag, MPLS tag, with the label number 70. Fine. And now it will send it out from S1/0. So this time R2 will receive labeled packet. R2 will receive, so it will perform lookup in its LFIB. So MPLS, if it receives anything with label number 17, then it will perform popping and will send it out from S1/1. Fine. It's very simple. See how many bytes have been switched with the help of tag. Right? So finally, packet will be delivered onto. See, R2 have not opened its IP header because R2 have switched your packets based on their label numbers. So finally, R3 will receive it, and R3 will receive unlabeled packet. Unlabeled. Because popping has been already done by R2. So it will perform lookup in its FIB to reach. So it is reachable out from, and there is no tag switching. See, so it will send unlabeled packet out from this interface. Fine. Whenever packet will come back from there, at that moment source will become 6.0. First of all, this Microsoft CE2 itself will perform routing lookup. So it is reaching this 10.1.1.1 via 2.2. So it will send this packet towards 2.2. 2.2 is this. R3 will receive this packet onto this F0/0 and unlabeled packet, right? So it will perform lookup in its FIP. So it will say show IP ceph 10.1.0 and now detail. Outgoing interface is S1/0. Next hop is 1111 and tag, which has to be imposed onto it, is what? 16. So it will again add tag 16 in between layer 2 and layer 3 header before transmitting this packet out from S1/0. And then finally R2 will receive it on S1/1 with label number 16. So if it receives anything with 16, again it has to perform popping, and it has to send it out from S1/0. So finally R1 will receive this packet onto S1/0 without any label. So it will perform lookup in its FIP, and once again R1 will send this packet towards CE1. So in this way, traffic is going from C1 to C2 and coming back from C2 to C1. I hope that you people have understood the traffic flow, the data flow, that how traffic is going from here to there, even R2 do not have anything in its routing table. But the thing is, like for an example, on Microsoft CE2, you are doing continuous ping, and of course it will be successful. But if you move on R2 and then if you say no IP, sir, what is this? That's why I say that SEF is what? Mandatory. Because if SEF is not there, ALFI will not be there. If SEF is not there, then ALFI will not be there. Like you can move on R2 and you can check show MPLS forwarding table. Fine, say IP SEF. Once you will configure this command, that's why I said that SEF is mandatory.
Of course,
it has to do. In BGP, there will be always recursive lookup because, as it was showing me, right? Where is that? That's what I'm saying. See? Where? This one. Of course, it has to perform recursive lookup. Because if you check its BGP table, show IP route, right? So there is that, okay, 10.1.6 is reachable via BGP, but there is no exit interface. That's why. In BGP, you will never see your exit interface. I hope you people have understood it completely. Great. Now, this time, let's assume that there is Yahoo. It is also using same prefixes. What will happen now? Of course, because for P1, there will be only one path will be best path. Either towards Microsoft CE1 or Yahoo CE1. Is not it? So if they are using same prefixes, then this is a big problem now. Are you getting my point or not? That is why we have to use VRF. We have to use VRF. And then after we have to use MPLS VPN as well. We have to use MPLS VPN. Till now I'm not using any MPLS VPN over here. I just implemented BGP along with MPLS and it was working fine. If you are having only one customer, but if you are having more than one customer terminating on a single router and they are using same prefixes, then of course there is a big problem now. So I hope that you people have understood that why do we require to implement VRF along with MPLS. Sardeep, of course there will be a big problem if they are using same prefixes, right? To solve this problem, and I'll be using same prefixes now, to solve this problem, I'll start to use VRF. Any problem? Now I will start to use VRF. Fine. I don't need to make any change at the end of Microsoft CE1 and CE2 because they don't need to do any configuration related to MPLS VPN and all. Because MPLS VPN will be configured at the end of provider only. At the end of, see, customer will never come to know that whether MPLS is enabled or some what was going on at the end of service provider. Because at the end of customer, we haven't enabled anything related to MPLS. Right? Is you student worry to come late? Fine. So let's do one thing. Same. अच्छा तुम हमारे क्लास में तो नहीं आए ना? जब हम वहाँ पे क्लासेस. Fine. I have removed this BGP. I have removed RIM. I will not remove SPF because OSP will still be required over there, right? Because still you have to configure indirect neighborship in between two PE provider edge. So SPF will remain there. In same manner, onto our P2, no router EICRP. I removed BGP as well, right? Fine, guys. So this time here I'll be using ESERP 1 only, not 100 actually. I'll be using only 1. Fine. So let's start it once again from V1. Let me create one VRF for Microsoft. IP VRF Micro. Now this time you are going to have same prefixes into two different VRFs, right? Then how will it be possible for a device to, or how will it be possible for BGP to distinguish them? For that purpose, in each VRF we have to use RD. RD is known as route distinguisher. RD is known as route distinguisher. So what is the meaning by distinguisher? I mean, which can differentiate, which can differentiate. So RD can be represent, I mean, will be configured in this format, like 16 bits colon 16 bits. You can take any value. But remember, on a single router, on two different VRFs, you cannot configure same RD value. Let me show you. RD is going to be, let's say here, 1:1. Then do one thing, create one another VRF, let's say Yahoo. Say RD. So you cannot allocate same RD to two different VRF on a single device, because of course both VRFs can have same prefixes. Then how will it be possible for them to differentiate them? You understand? So it is mandatory, it is compulsory that on a single device, if you are creating two different VRFs, then make sure that you are allocating it unique RD, route distinguisher. So again, say IP VRF is what? Micro. And then RD is what? 1:1. Fine. Understood? Great. Just come outside. Show IP VRF. Have you put any interface on inside this VRF till now? No. And we know very well that this customer, Microsoft CE1, I mean Microsoft, is going to be member of, I mean, for that customer we are using VRF Micro. Now interface FA0x0 is used by customer Microsoft. So I'll say IP VRF forwarding name is, it will remove its IP address as I said earlier on. Allocate it once again. Show IP VRF, check it out. Now FA0x0 is member of VRF Micro. Now in global routing table, you will not be able to see 192.168.1.0 because it have become the member of VRF Micro. But if you say show IP route VRF Micro, this is there. Understood? Fine. Now, because this time we are going to configure MPLS VPN, right, in between PE1 and PE2 provider edge, in between two provider edges as routers, this time we are going to configure VPN. We will configure VPN, right? So to configure VPN, it's not very difficult in BGP, you see. Because this time VPN will work for VRF, right? And without VPN, you cannot take your VRF prefixes. Remember, BGP can carry prefixes of VRF via VPN only. Right? So, actually this VPN do not belongs to your MPLS. It belongs to your BGP itself. Like this, router BGP, let's say it is 100. Of course, it was 100. Say, no BGP default IPv4 unicast. Even you can also say BGP router ID is what? And then say neighbor 333 remote AS is tell me the neighbor. Create address family, not IPv4. Create in for IPv6 we are having VPN. But here we are using VPN, I mean IPv4, so VPN v4 only. See, enter. That's a neighbor is what? Active. To configure VPN, I mean, in this way you will configure this VPN, right? See, now you can ask me that why are we going, or why is it necessary for us to configure VPN? See, VPN works same as trunk port. Like trunk port, all VLANs are allowed. In same manner, prefixes from all VRFs will be allowed via VPN. It can allow prefixes with different route distinguisher values. It can allow prefixes with different route distinguisher values, because for each VRF you will allocate a different RD value, route distinguisher, is not it? So move on now. R3 router BGP 100, say no BGP, default IP V4 unicast, create address family IP V4, sorry, neighbor 1.1.1, remote AS is going to be 100, neighbor and address family VPN V4, neighbor. So now you have configured VPN V4 neighborship, and it will come up now very soon. Don't worry about that. It will show you, it will generate a log masses, its log masses onto the console of both devices. Neighborship have came up. Now, show IP BGP something. Is it showing you anything? Because it will show you IPv4 neighborship only, not VPN V4. To see your VPN V4 neighborship, it's very simple. Say show IP BGP all summary. Check it out. Understood? There is no VRF, sorry, there is no neighbor for dedicated VRF. Like in place of all, you could say VRF and then say, does it have anything? For a dedicated VRF, we do not have any neighbor. Right now, we are having for all. That's why VPN V4, and I said, that's why I said that this VPN V4 will work as a trunk port. Hello? So we have configured VPN V4 neighborship in between R1 and R3. Fine. Now on PE1, we have to configure RIP for VRF micro, because RIP is running in between PE and CE. Right now, what is running? RIP in between PE and CE. So do one thing on 2R1, say router RIP, because you can run only a single process of RIP globally on your device. And then do not configure network command, do not configure any version command, because here you haven't configured this RIP for any VRF. Now say address family IPv4 VRF name is micro. Of course. Because I'm using only micro for Microsoft. So I have to configure it for that same VRF only. Of course, you will not configure it for any other VRF. Right? Because for this customer, you are using VRF micro. Are you getting my point or not? Fine. Address family IPv4 VRF micro. And before going to configure this RIP, I would like to show you something. That when you configure VPN V4 neighborship, then it will configure these commands automatically, like show run pipe section router BGP. Let me show you. I didn't configure this command over here, but this command has been configured over here auto, like under VPN V4. I simply said activate. I didn't configure this send community extended, but this command will appear automatically, and it is mandatory. If you do not configure this command, then VPN V4 will never work. However, it will be configured by your iOS automatically, but if you remove it, like in T-Shoot, they can remove it. So your VPN will not work. I'll let you know that why is it necessary? Why is it mandatory for us? Fine. And then also, I didn't configure, did I create any IPv4? I mean, any address family for my VRF into BGP? Did I create any address family for my VRF Microsoft in BGP? Of course no, but it have created it automatically. See, remember, if your router is having BGP VPN v4 neighborship, just try to remember, try to get it. If your router is having BGP VPN v4 neighborship, VPN v4 neighborship is configured onto your device, and then after, if you create any VRF onto your router, it will create address family for that VRF automatically. Just like here, as you can see that I didn't configure address family for this VRF onto this, I mean inside BGP, I didn't configure anything related to this address family, right? But still it have created it automatically. Don't worry about that, right? Now configure RIP. To configure RIP, it's very simple. Address family IPv4, VRF name is what? Micro. This is for RIP. And then say not or summary version to network. Fine. Now RIP has been configured for VRF micro. Now inside micro, you must start to receive all prefixes coming from Microsoft C1. Let me show you. See, in global routing table, there will not be anything. See, but if you say show IP route VRF is what? Micro. Let me show you. It's same as VRF light. It's same as VRF light. That's why I taught you VRF light first, right? Now, then after, these prefixes will never go via BGP without redistribution. Without, of course, you have to redistribute this, these prefixes from RIP into BGP so that your prefixes can go through VPN. They can go through VPN. Are you getting my point or not? Fine. Then after it, you see show MPLS forwarding table. Is there any change till now? Is there any change? It is like same as we saw earlier on, right? Fine. Now we are going to redistribute this RIP into BGP VPN. To do that, router BGP 100. Address family IPv4, unicast VRF name was. You will not redistribute it under VPN v4 address family, no. You will redistribute all these prefixes learned from RIP into BGP in its VRF only. In its VRF only. And that is why BGP created this address family for this VRF automatically. Now, say redistribute what? RIP. That's the only command that you need to put over here. Now, after doing this, after configuring this command, let me show you. Show IP, BGP, VPN v4, all. Enter. So it will show you all that. See, VRF, what? Micro. And its RD value is what? 1:1. Even you can check it out in this manner as well. Show IP, BGP, VPN v4, VRF is what? Micro. Per VRF. If you say all, enter, then it will show you prefixes. BGP table for all VRF. It will show you BGP table for all VRFs. But this time, it will show you BGP table only for one VRF. You can specify your VRF as well as you can also use all keyword. I hope you people have understood it. Fine. After it, because here we have redistributed it, right? After this redistribution, right? Even you can also use that route map over here. Do you remember that I created one route map of test so that the prefix it running in between PE1 and C1 will not get redistributed into BGP. Hello, this 1.0 is not required because only these 5 prefixes are running in the lane of the Microsoft C1. So do one thing at the time of redistribution from RIP into BGP, just exclude it. So to do that, say router BGP 100 address family, and then as you configured redistribute RIP, say route map test. It was already configured over here, right? So IP BGP, VPN v4, VRF, micro. Is there any problem now? पॉइंट टू पॉइंट में क्यों जरूरत ही क्या, मुझे पता है इधर से मैं भेजूंगा उधर रिसीव होगा. ओके सो हैव आई कॉन्फिगर्ड एनी नेक्स्ट होप सेल्फ कमांड ओवर हियर. Now I must check all these prefixes available on R3, V2. So IP, VCP, VP, and V4, all. I have not created any VRF over here. And also, let me do one thing. Move back again on PE1. Actually, here it is showing you that they are available in, I mean, you have redistributed them, right? But still, these prefixes will never go via VPN. I mean, they will go, but they will not be received by anyone. No one will be able to accept all these prefixes. Even what will I do to prove it? I will capture one link over here, start capturing. And now from PE1, I will say clear IP, clear IP, BGP, VPN, V4. Unicast star BGP VPN V4 cast star. See, BGP update must be there. This one, right? Open it. Does it have any prefix over here? So actually, even in updates, it is not advertising its prefixes. You get my point? We have proved that R1 is not giving any prefix information to its VPN V4 neighbor. So remember that if you are giving, just try to remember now, this is really crucial point, right, of this MPLS VPN. If you are giving or if you are injecting prefixes from VRF into VPN is known as export, is known as exporting, like you are exporting your prefixes, right? Hello. If you are giving prefixes, I mean if you are injecting prefixes from VRF into VPN, yes, as we did over here. From VRF, we injected these prefixes into VPN by performing redistribution. Are you getting my point? And then if you are taking routes VPN from VPN back into VRF, is known as import. Same as normal export and import. Have you understood that when will you call it import and when will you call export? If you are injecting prefixes from VRF into VPN is known as exporting. And if you are taking routes, taking prefixes from VPN back into VRF is known as importing. There are some route target values, RT values for export and for import. That must be mentioned. Like if you are going to post anything, then you must configure to and from. You must configure what? To and from. Because to means your destination address, right? So wherever destination address will match, it will be delivered. So you are sending your prefixes, you are transmitting your prefixes via VPN without allocating its address, without allocating that information that which router or which person would be able to import these prefixes. How can you export them? So for doing that, you have to allocate export value. See, remember, if you are exporting anything from VRF into VPN, then make sure that you have allocated an export route target value. You understand? So on R1, I didn't configure any export route target values. So on to PE1 itself, go to IPVRF, you understand? IPVRF, name is what?
Micro.
Say route target, RT, route target, there are two things, export as well as import. And if you want to use same for both, right now we are exporting only, right? We are not importing anything, right? So you could also say both as well, so that it will use same value for exporting as well as for importing. But this time I'm just doing what? Export. So I'll say export is what? 1:2. Let's say I'm using here 1:2. This is like 2, address 2. Like when you post something, then you mention 2, destination address. You understand? Fine. This is export RT. Fine. After allocating this export RT, you can also see show IP VRF detail. RD is this, onto this interface is configured, and export RT is this. And now this RT value will always go along with your BGP prefixes as extended community, as you can see. This export RT will always go along with your BGP prefixes as extended community. That is why that command is mandatory. If that command is not configured, then it will never be able to carry your RT value along with BGP prefixes in BGP updates. And this RT value is mandatory. That is why that extended community command is automatically configured. Have you understood it now? Fine. Then after, if you capture it once again, and once again clear it from here and open it. Oh, what? Yes, but still it is not showing me like yes. I mean, extended community is there, but prefixes are still not there. Because the point is, onto R3 no one is available to accept them. No one is available to accept these prefixes with these RT values, route target. So it is also mandatory that on far end, you must have VRF. You must have VRF. And also it is not mandatory to use same VRF name. Like it is not mandatory that onto PE2 use same VRF. No. Just say IP VRF. Let's say its name is what? Mike. RT, it is also not mandatory to use the same as like we used on PE1. But it is recommended to use same one. I will be using different over here, like 2:2. RD, what? Yep, you can use anything, but it is recommended to use same RD values on both ends. RD, this is not RT, this is not route target, this is route distinguisher. You can use anything, but it is always recommended to use same. I will let you know that why is it recommended to use it as same, right? Fine. Then you have to allocate route target, but this time you are importing. And this import value must be same as that you that you used at the time of exporting the prefixes into your VPN. If it is not same, then you will not be able to import those prefixes into this VRF. So actually it is not depending on the VRF name that which prefixes will get installed your VRF. It is depending on your route target values. So remember that whatever you used over there at the time of export, here you have to use that same RT value for importing the prefixes. If you do not use same, then it won't be able to import them from VPN into VRF. So import is what? Fine. And as I said that it will create address family automatically for it, for this VRF, because VPN VPN neighbor CPU is already there. So let me show you. So run pipe section router BGP. For Mike. Now let me show you. Show IP BGP VPN V for all. Enter. It have received them, right? And let me show you update packet as well. Update message is given by 1, 2, 3. See. You understand? Even I think older update was also containing this thing, right? Let me open that as well once again. The older update, where was that? See, it was also containing, but at that moment, see, RT was also there. Extended community, right? RT was also there. Prefixes were going there, but over there you didn't create any VRF, you didn't configure any route import value. That is why far end was not having those prefixes in its BCP table. Understood? Now we configured here. We configured VRF, right? And you can say show IP route, VRF is what? Mic. In VRF mic. Not in global routing table, check it out. It's not available in global routing table. But the problem is show IP BGP, VPN V4, VRF mic. But if you say all, VPN V4, all. There are multiple entries, there are duplicate entries for same prefixes. One is coming with that we configured on 2R1, and here we configured them with RD value. Here we configured this VRF with RD value 2:2. So there is no problem with routing and all, but there are duplicate entries, so there will be higher memory consumption because they are coming with RD value 1:1, but here we configured as 2:2. However, it has to receive it because we configured same route target value for importing. So there are duplicate entries now. To do not have duplicate entries, it is recommended to use same RD value, and it is not very easy to use, to change your RD value. IPVRF is mic. Say RD is what? 1:1. Same as previously. What is it saying? That remove previous one. So you have to say RD2:2. Sorry. No. And then say RD1:2. It will not take it immediately. What is it saying? Deletion of RD is in progress. So you have to do it. I don't know exactly. Today, right? And then after you can say clear BGP VPN V4 unicast star in check show IP BGP VPN V4 all. There will be only one entry now. See, sorry, is there any duplicate entry now? Tell me and show IP route. There is nothing, but if you say here you created VRF with the name of mic, it will take some time, but finally all those prefixes will be available in its routing table. Don't worry about that. If they are available in the BGP table, then definitely they will also be available in its routing table as well. Don't worry about that, they will come. But then after, let me show you some other changes as well. I hope that you people have understood all this concept till now, because it was so easy, and I'm going just step by step. I'm just going through steps, right? It's not like that I just configured it without any reason. Move on our PE1. So I hope that you people have understood the uses of RT value route target, and this RT value will always go along with BGP updates as extended community. That is why that command is mandatory, that iOS configured automatically just after configuring VPN V4 neighborship. So after going through all these things on V1 itself, I redistributed RIP into VCP. Remember that whenever your prefixes will be injected from VRF into VPN. Of course, over here on P1, you injected your prefixes like 10.1.0, 2.0, 3.0, 4.0, /24, 5.0, /24. These five prefixes into VPN. Do you remember, Rijvi? We injected five prefixes from VRF into VPN. Show NPLS, you see. Show IP, BGP, VPN, V4, all. As you can see over here, five prefixes, right? At same moment, you check its MPLS forwarding table as well. Show MPLS forwarding table. These five prefixes. See, once your prefix will be injected from VRF into VPN, immediately its entry will also be created in its local LFIB. LFIB, this is local forwarding information. I mean label forwarding information base, LFIB, label forwarding information base. And for all those prefixes which have moved from VRF into, which have been injected from VRF into VPN, it will create a label. As you can see, local. But outgoing is what? Untagged, because hey guys, it is having these prefixes in its LFIB, and before that it was not having any label. I mean, these prefixes were not coming with any label. Hello, Microsoft, is Microsoft C1 giving these prefixes to BGP with any label? That's why outgoing label is what? Untagged. Hello. Hey, you have redistributed it onto Agar sir. Fine. So this V is specify VPN label, or you can say like VRF, VPN or VRF, whatever you want, right? So you can see that for it, its exit interface is what? FA0x0, and next hop is what? 1.1, because exit interface is FA0x0. Remember that if your exit interface is Ethernet port, then next hop address will always be mentioned over there. Always. Like as you said, that on point to point, next hop is never mentioned, right? Of course, for point to point, it is not necessary, but if it is multi-point interface, then it is mandatory to specify your next hop address as well. Fine. Then and this label is not been generated by LDP. This label has been generated by VPN, BGP VPN V4. This label has been generated by VPN V4. That's why this V is specified, I mean is there. Remember, whenever you will inject, again I'm repeating my this line because this is really important, right? Whenever you will inject prefixes from VRF into VPN, then VPN and I mean BGP VPN will also generate a label for it, as you can see over here. And this is what? Local label. This is what? Local label, as you can see. So now if you open its BGP table for VPN V4 for this prefix, like show IP, BGP, VPN V4, unicast, and then the .1.0, enter. Unicast VRF is what? Micro, and then the .1.0, because here on P1 I'm using VRF name as micro. So you see in the label, because this is local label, right? This is what? Local label. That is why it will be under in. So it has generated label number 21 for 10.1.1.0, as you can see. Show NPLS forwarding table here as well. See, label number, sorry, this one, 19. It's not it. And here also it was showing me, it is for 10.1.0. So this is 10.1.0.
guys, see, it is proved now that it has created label for it, VPN label, right? Now it is having VPN v4 membership with R3, so it will give this label to R3, and for R3 this label will become outgoing label, same as LDP. Hello. If it is giving this label to PE2 now, as you can see, but you will not be able to see that in its LFIP, no? You won't be able to see that in its LFIP, because that was generated by VPN, not by LDP. That label was generated by VPN, and you are having those prefixes in your VPN only, right? So check it out, show BGP VPN v4 unicast all, or you can say VRF mic 10.1.0. so that label number 21 must be your outgoing label now. You understand? And because this is in VRF mic, if you check SAF table now, SAF onto this PE2, show IP SAF VRF mic for which prefix in SAF, how many labels have to be imposed now? 2, 16 and 21. Inner label will always be your VPN label. So as you can see, to reach 10.1.0, outgoing label was 21, so it is inner label. Outer label will always be your LDP label, because to reach next hop is what? And here next hop self was not required, right? Because in VPN v4 next hop self is already configured for, I mean, like you can see over here, right? Redistributed prefixes, next hop self is not required to configure over here, right? So as you can see that next hop is already 1111. So one label 16 is just to reach your next hop, and this 21 is your VPN label. There are two labels now, LDP label and VPN label. LDP will be outer label and inner label will be your VPN label. You understand? So finally, show IP route VRF is what? Mic. You have received on PE2 all these prefixes in your VRF mic. And this time you have to configure EICRP in between, yes, R3, or you can also call it PE2 and Microsoft CE2. So let's configure EICRP at EICRP 1, right? So at the end of Microsoft CE2, hello, no router EICRP 100, say router EICRP, this time I have to configure EICRP 1, not or something network. This is at the end of customer will never require to do any extra configuration. But if you move on R3 now, router EICRP 100 or 1000. Now you will say, sir, how will it be possible to form neighborship? See, this is the global process. Now inside it, you have to create a test family for IPv4 VRF. Name is, and then after you have to define your autonomous system in it, and this AS number must match with your neighbor AS. So here now neighborship must come up for VRF. I think I haven't put this interface into VRF yet. IP VRF. God, I didn't configure this controller. Now it will delete it. Now membership will also come up. For VRF, as you can see, show IP, SERP name. Is it showing you anything over here? No. Say show IP, SERP, VRF, mic, neighbor. Now it will show you. And then show IP route. Here it won't show you anything. But if you say show IP route, VRF, mic. Some prefixes are coming via BGP and some of them are coming from ESERP. Now you have to distribute prefixes from BGP into ESERP so that you can get them onto Microsoft CE2. Do one thing. Yes. This is called MPBCP that you saw in Wireshark as well. That prefixes were going under MPBGP, multi-protocol BGP. Router ESERP 1000, say address family IPv4, VRF is what? Mic. Say redistribute, BGP is what? 100. Then it is mandated to specify your now you will say, sir, during redistribution we didn't define VRF. Why do we require to define VRF as we have already entered into VRF? So we are already inside VRF mic. So in VRF mic, we are redistributing BGP into ESERP. So of course, only those prefixes will get redistributed into ESERP which are present into the VRF mic via BGP. Finally, move on. Check it out. Check it out. All of them are available over here. Right? After it, again you have to redistribute this ESERP back into BGP. So on to R3C, issue MPLS forwarding table. Still there is no prefix, right? Is there? Because onto this device I have not injected anything from VRF into VPN. So for doing that, first of all, show IP VRF detail. I have to put any RT value for exportation, for exporting, right? So IP VRF mic route target for exporting different ways to one. So over there it will be used as a import one. Then after you do one thing, router BGP address family IPv4 VRF, tell me, say redistribute one. To check your redistribution, say show IP BGP VPN V4, all enter. Is not it? If you don't want to redistribute this 2.0, which is running in between PE2 and CE2, do one thing, router BGP 100, go to address family, and during redistribution, say route map is already there. Test. I already created it. Show route map. Show IP BGP VPN V4 VRF is what? Mike, you can also check your BGP table per VRF as well. See, all of them have redistributed 6 to 10. Fine, guys. Then it will advertise it towards now PE1. Show IP BGP. As you can see, all as well. But still it's not there because we have not configured any RT value over here. So it is mandatory to configure RT for importing prefixes from VPN into. And one more thing that I would like to show you over here on PE2, just after performing redistribution, right? I mean, just after injecting prefixes from VRF into VPN. Let me show you. Show MPLS forwarding table. Same as P1. For all those prefixes, it have also created some VPN labels. And now these labels will also go along with MPBGP updates. So for PE1, these labels will become outgoing labels. Hello, because these are local labels for it, right? So that for its VPN v4 neighbor, these labels will become outgoing label. Hello. So finally, let PE1 to receive them. For doing that, say IPVRF is what? Micro route target for importing is what? And then you can say clear BGP VPN v4 unicast star in check show IP BGP VPN v4 all of them are there. Next hop have modified automatically. Understood? Hello. Show IP and you see show MPLS forwarding table in its LFIP there will not be any entry for 6, 7, 8, 9, or 10 because here you didn't inject them from VRF into VPN, right? Here you injected only 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 from VRF into VPN. That is why you are having those entries into its LFIP. And I will let you know that why is it necessary to have over here, right? Fine, guys. Then after it, you can check routing table. So if you route VRF micro, you will receive some prefixes coming from with the help of BGP. See, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Understood? Then further you have to redistribute BGP back into RIP. So router, and here BGP redistribute internal is also not required. That command BGP redistribute internal is also not required if you are redistributing from BGP into any IGP now. Now, because in BGP you learned them with the help of VPN. It was not exact IBGP neighbor. This time it is IBGP VPN v4 neighbor. Router RIP. Address assembly IPv4, VRF is what? Micro, say redistribute, BGP is what? 100, metric is what? 1. Now you must be able to see them onto Microsoft CE1 and then you will see that communication have started. Now, question is that how communication is happening? In same manner I will teach you, right? That I explained the data flow in previous just before configuring this VRF. See, first of all, it has to look up for the destination. Destination was? Tell me. 6.0. This packet will arrive on to R1 without any label. So R1 will receive this packet onto its FA0x0 with the label number or without label. Without label. Hello. Of course, because it is coming from customer, so it will come with, I mean this packet will come without any label, so it will receive it unlabeled, but this interface is part of VRF micro. Hello. So this time this PE1 is receiving this packet onto its FA0x0 inside VRF micro. Sardeep, this time it is not receiving this packet inside global routing table, this time it is receiving it inside VRF micro. So it will perform lookup in the SAF table of micro, of VRF micro. So it will say show IP SAF VRF micro for prefix. It will impose two labels now. One is VPN label, one is LDP label. One is VPN label, one is LDP label. Because as I show you here, this is what VPN route head. Means this is VPN route. It means that, hey, this 10.1.6.0 is coming here with the help of VPN, right? Inside this VRF micro. So there will be outgoing label because this label have been generated by P2. Hello? P2 generated this label actually for 10.1.6.0. This label number is what? 23. Hey guys, move on here for 6.0. 20. Local label is 23, so it is giving to its neighbor PE1. So for PE1, it have become outgoing label. And 17 is just to reach next hop. 17 is just to reach your next hop, which is 3333.
So it will send this packet out from S1 by 0 with the two labels 17 and 23. 17 will be top label, and 23 will be inner label. Fine. Now R2 will receive this packet. It will open first label, show MPLS forwarding table with the label number 17. 17 means it will perform popping. It will remove 17 and will send it out from S1 by 1. But still there was one another label was existing. So still R3 will receive this packet onto S1 by 0, and it will be labeled packet because one label was still there and that label number was 23. So if it receives anything with the label number 23, it will send it out from FA0 by 0 towards next stop 2.1, which is C2. Then packet will come back from there to here. It will receive that packet onto F0 by 0. Destination will be 10.1.1.1, right? So it will receive it unlabeled. So it has to perform lookup in itself for VRF mic. So now R3 will perform lookup in itself FIB for VRF mic. Hello, because FA0 by 0 of PE2 is in VRF mic. Show IP self VRF mic 10.1.0. This time inner label is what? And outer label is what? 21. This 21 is VPN label, 16 is what? LDP label. For next hop. So this, and it will send it out from S1 by 0. So finally R2 will receive it onto S1 by 1. And R2 will receive it with the label number 16. So if it receive anything with the label number 16, will send it out from, it will not open its IP header. Will send it out from S1 by 0. It means that now R1 will receive it, and again it will receive it with the label number. Tell me 21. So if P1 receives anything with the label number 21, will send it out from SF0 by 0 towards next of 1.1. So finally packet will be delivered onto. Are you getting my point or not? So in this way your traffic is going from one side to another side. So I hope that you people have understood it, right? And now let me show you that okay, there are two labels now. Of course, because there was untagged. Outgoing label was untagged. You can see that. Otherwise, how will it be possible for? Okay.
You think interviews with Bob Pusti and the service providers of the MPDGP
government? Check it out. Source is in .1.1. How many labels are there?
Two.
Hello? One is 17. 17 is outer, just after layer 2. And then 17 is having S bit as 0 because it is also having one more label. And then final label is having S bit as 1. Means it is the last label before IP header. Tell me. So I hope that now you people have understood it, that how traffic is going from one side to another side with the help of MPLS. That is why I told you at that moment during BGP that over there you will not require to configure your GR eternal. However, still prefixes will not be available onto your core. Traffic is still going through it, right? See, traffic is still going through this core device and there is no prefix available in its routing table. So now your core have become BGP free core. You are not required to configure BGP onto your core device. You are just required to configure BGP only on edge devices. P routers. And of course, it's using fast switching. Done. Now, you do one thing. Move on Microsoft CE1. And then you can trace out 10.1. And one more thing. If you try to communicate with 10.6.1 now, it will not be able to communicate with it. See, ping 10.1.6.1 because you do not have reverse path. Hey, in source it will take 1.1, 192.168.1.1. So you have to put your source as loopback 1 because you didn't redistribute it there when networks. fine. Okay, then you can also trace route it. 10.1.6.1 when source is loopback. So it is showing you that okay, it is going through 12.1.2 as well, which is not good. If you want to hide your MPLS domain now, if you want to hide your MPLS domain, stop your TTL propagation. For doing that, go to PE1. As I have already taught you, the uses of this command. Now, see, what is it? See, 1.2, which is PE1, customer and device, and this is also customer and IP 2.2. See, entire MPLS domain has hidden.
R1, R2, R3.
Previously, it was showing me this 12.1.2, which is the core device IP. Is not it? And this time, it is showing you only this IP 1.2 and this outbound exit interface IP address 2.2. That whenever you will inject anything from VRF into VPN, it will generate its label. If it does not put that entry into its local show MPLS forwarding table, if it does not put these entries over here, then it will receive packet onto S1/0 coming from core router, P router. How will it be possible for this router to know that okay, I have to send this packet out from FA0/0 in VRF? Because this S1/0 is part of global routing table. Are you getting my point or not? That is why it is mandatory to have these entries in its LFIP. Because traffic is, see traffic, just try to think in perspective of traffic, is going from VRF into global and back from global to VRF. Is not it?